The NBA on NBC is brought to you by Miller Lite. Great taste, less filling. Can your beer do this? By Pizza Hut, who reminds you that anytime's a great time to stop and smell the pizza. And by Nissan, it's time to expect more from a car.
Cradle of Texas Liberty, the Alamo City of San Antonio, the life down as they introduce by spotlight the starting lineups. Here they are for Utah. John Stockton, again, the top distributor of the ball in the NBA. And Jeff Hornacek acquired from the 76ers after the All-Star break for scoring punch. On the front line for Utah, Felton Spencer, 7 feet, muscle and rebounder. The mailman, Karl Malone, again in the top five in scoring in the NBA. And Tyrone Corbin. Coached by Jerry Sloan, now in his sixth year in Utah, he is the all-time winningest Jazz coach, over 300 victories. For San Antonio, Vinny Del Negro and Willie Anderson form the backcourt for the Spurs. On the front line, David Robinson averaged nearly 30 points a game. Edge Shaq O'Neal for the scoring title in the final game of the season. Dennis Rodman, 17 rebounds a game. Third straight year he's led all in rebounding, a rare feat for a forward in this league. And Dale Ellis is the all-time NBA three-point shooter. And their coach, the fiery, flamboyant John Lucas. Lucas, whose team won 6 more games this year than last. The fourth seed in the West, Utah seeded 5th. A game that features some of the NBA's most familiar faces.
You know, the Utah Jazz felt very good about coming in here because they had played them so well in the regular season. San Antonio, until Thursday night, was not the aggressor in the series at all. Now the pressure goes back to the Jazz, and we'll find out whether they can answer the challenge this afternoon.
And they'll jump it again. The officials today, Jess Kersey, Bob Delaney, and Ed F. Rush. Del Negro, San Antonio.
At the point of attack, this is where we should watch and see whether John Stockton is going to be able to impact Vinny Del Negro because he took it very personally in game one. Didn't do a good job.
The Admiral, David Robinson, over the swiping try of Karl Malone. Corbin, Del Negro, and Stockton. Malone likes to work from the left side of the basket, and that's where he is now. Rodman on him. Malone with a power move. Rodman denies. It comes out to Corbin. Blocked by Robinson. They break out 3-on-2. Now slow it down. Robinson and Rodman just now getting into the picture.
The way you beat the San Antonio is to keep pressure on the guard. Dale Ellis, who really didn't get off in the game against him on Thursday night, trying to get off very quickly now.
Still bothered by a bad foot. And the illegal defense. Boy, that's a quick call. You don't usually see that in the first minute and 5 seconds of a game. So a warning for John Lucas' Spurs.
Well, I think that they're aware that Dennis Rodman has a very difficult job in trying to keep Karl Malone out of the post. So Willie Anderson and David Robinson are both trying to find out where he is and then slide back in to be able to give help.
Stockton partially blocked. Rodman to Robinson. And he's fouled by Hornacek. And Hornacek and Robinson, a little knee from the Admiral, and Rodman in there makes sure that his man is well protected. Might be a flagrant foul.
David Robinson just got a thumbnail on that. Excuse me, that was Willie Anderson that got the piece of that ball, and then they sprint the other way.
Dennis Rodman gets a technical foul. And Stockton, no, it'll be Hornacek to the other end to shoot. 1 for Utah.
Now, that's what happens when you have the reputation. He arrived late. very late on the scene and immediately got snatched with the whistle, and he led the league this year in technicals, and they cannot afford to lose Rodman here early in the contest.
First point for Utah, and now back to the other end. Well, Robinson will shoot a pair. But Rodman, while at times he seems emotionally not in control, knows the switches. He knows how to alter, but for the rest of this game, he'll have to remember he cannot carry on beyond the limit, or he's lost to this San Antonio cause.
Most of what Dennis Rodman does is for effect. He wants to be an irritant to anybody that's out there on the floor. That's the opposition and the officials. It cost him in the first 2 minutes of the ball game.
Go off 4 points to David Robinson. Rebound Robinson. He's doing everything. Block shots, 2 rebounds, 4 points in the first 2 minutes. Dale Ellis. And San Antonio leads it 6-1.
In the game on Thursday, it was 11-2 start before the Jazz got in it. It was Karl Malone that carried him in that first quarter. And what Utah is trying to do is get something going to the basket, because they had no inside high percentage shots in game one.
Kick by Ellis. Utah, as Jerry Sloan knows, that his team does not do well when sacrificing the early lead. It's not a team that scores a lot of points in a hurry. They don't run. It's a half-court game.
They are not an explosive team that can make up a deficit, so they've got to stay close. They want to control the tempo. They want to grind it out. Malone at the basket.
Unable to score, but a push from Dale Ellis.
On the Spurs, number 3, Dale Ellis.
Malone, who used to march to the free throw line more than any NBA player by a bunch, used to make more free throws than the man in second place attempted, but not this year. David Robinson and Shaq O'Neal both with more attempts.
This year his percentage is down, and I think one of the reasons is right at the end of his release he leans back a little bit and it pulls him off the ball, but this guy has just been a terrific offensive machine for the Utah Jazz.
Been in the top 10 in scoring and rebounding this year. One of only three, Shaquille O'Neal and Hakeem. Second chance for Utah. Stockton slipping in to make the play. Utah looking for its first connect.
Well, Stockton has had a tough time getting started at the offensive end, and certainly he's got to look to find ways to score right now, trying to get the ball back to the money man in Malone.
And Malone's pass off the head of Rodman, and Stockton steals it. One of the leaders in steals the last 10 years, Stockton, off San Antonio to Utah. Rodman didn't agree, but he better not argue too openly.
John Stockton with a terrific steal, and then on the way back in with a little hesitation, the ball came clearly off Stockton.
Now Stockton connects, and it's 6-4 San Antonio. Robinson wide open, and Rodman. Rodman, who does not score much, less than 5 points a game, but he's in love, he's infatuated at least with a three-point play. Wide open is Ty Corbin.
They did not get a score from that small forward position in that first half of play. And that's Corbin, David Benoit, Byron Russell. All, one of those guys is going to have to give them some fire power from that three spot.
Didn't get a basket from the big guy, Tom Chambers, either, who had a dismal game. Oh,
yeah, you had to throw that in, too. So, in other words, they just had a bad offensive game.
They're 1-for-6 today and a whistle away from the ball. A hold underneath on Del Negro. As his hands full with Stockton. Did a good job on Thursday night. Underrated player.
Stockton has a foot speed to go by him, but that's not part of their game plan for him to create that kind of penetration. He got nailed on the screen.
Stockton with a pick on Rodman, and survived it, and Malone gets the ball back.
Look at Rodman. He's looking at the official saying, you didn't see that?
Stockton. Spencer with a rebound. And another miss. Utah ice cold. Nice pass. Del Negro to Rodman. Dennis Rodman with 4 points. He averaged on the year 4.7.
That's a terrific play for Del Negro and Rodman to hook up on.
Malone. Rebound Robinson is fourth. Look at that. Stockton hustle and deflect the ball and a foul.
David Robinson out of control will pick up a charge.
His first.
The Utah Jazz require John Stockton to set screens. Now he'll come across and really take the shot from Rodman, but pop out to get a chance to shoot the ball.
Stockton at 6'1 and 175. That's even light for a defensive back in the NFL. Spencer knocked away, but right to Karl Malone, and he can't hit. Corbin. Utah getting a lot of second chances, but not converting those either.
They're a little tight right now, and they're trying too hard. In game one, Malone was perfect in his offensive rhythm, and right now he realizes he's got to carry a bigger load. He hasn't been able to get off the snide.
Hornacek with a quick release over Robinson. Rodman with a rebound. 3-on-2. Rodman. Oh, no one to pass to, and it goes off Rodman out of bounds.
And David Robinson was on the other side but lost his footing, and that's who Rodman saw out of the corner of his eye, ends up in a turnover.
Malone in the exchange with Rodman, a little push on Dennis Rodman. We'll see what might develop. 1-for-12 for Utah. Malone, this is, it's a 1-for-13. Gets it back and a foul. And getting there. Very close to something nasty. And perhaps the best thing that could happen at this stage, a time out. 6:59 left in the opening quarter. It's San Antonio in front by 6. Welcome back to the Alamo Dome. Yesterday, talking with Jerry Sloan, he was a bewildered coach after the defeat in game one and explained what his team had to do today.
We want to push the ball up the floor, obviously, against them, but also once we push the ball up the floor, then we've got to use patience. It's kind of like boxing, I guess, you know. If you don't, you've got to have patience to a certain extent, and then all of a sudden you've got to be ready to explode, and we didn't really do that. We just kind of walked through it, and that's when you get hurt.
There's a lot more between the lines there that might have first appeared.
Well, they were not only hurt, but they played days through most of game one, and they're trying to really be aggressive, but they're overly aggressive. They're out of control right now, and particularly at the offensive end, you have to have that fine point where you're aggressive but relaxed. Otherwise, you get nothing. They've yet to make a field goal.
Karl Malone, his second free throw. He's 0 for 4 from the line, fifth in the league in scoring this year. One of the top rebounders as well. Ten, six, San Antonio. They go up to Salt Lake City, Delta Center for games 3 and 4, if necessary. Alone on Robinson, 6 on the clock. Malone wins that battle.
The best thing for the Jazz is they have been awful from the field, and yet they're in the ball game. They're only down 4, so they know that they still have a chance. Nice play. Can't finish.
Corbin can't hit. The front court 0-for-8 now for Utah. Turnover. Hornacek in the right spot for the Jazz. The tough defense of San Antonio. Utah not getting any easy shots, and the fall away by Malone misses. 0 for 9 now from the front court, and Malone has missed all five of his attempts.
As good as he was on Thursday, he's that bad this afternoon, but he's going to have to shoot volume in order to get his numbers, but he's got to keep shooting.
Ellis thought he had that three, and it kicked out.
Malone is looking for something cheap, and he thought he had it that time, but David Robinson made him make an adjustment.
Turnover. Hornacek sets up John Stockton. And finally, the Jazz get a score. 10-8. With 5:11 to go in the opening quarter.
See, and that's, if you're Jerry Sloan, you say, as bad as we've been, guys, we're only down two. This team is not running away and hiding like it did in game one.
Robinson over Malone. He's a little short. Hornacek. Looking for Karl Malone. Wasn't in that spot.
Stockton looked over and said, Jeff, you shoot, I bet.
And Sloan underlining that philosophy. Interesting. Hurry the ball up. They like to rush it into the offensive end, then patiently set up the shot. And, of course, Stockton is the trigger man who takes a breather now. And Jay Humphries makes his first appearance, number 6, 10-year veteran from Colorado. Robinson keeping that ball high. As soon as he gets it low, you can see Malone slam it.
Shot clock at 3.
Malcolm Spencer, they're going to call that goaltending. It looked as if it was way short. The Jazz and Sloan can't believe it. I don't think the ball had a chance to go in.
And that's the way that goaltending should be judged. The ball has to have a chance to go in. Del Negro just launches it. Spencer goes up. Well, it's still on the way down.
That was the angle from which it was called. And so it stands. So Del Negro throws up a prayer. Those aren't often answered, but Felton Spencer was kind, and it's a three-point play.
Lucas is the kind of coach that looks for omens and good signs. That certainly has to be a good sign for him, because that ball had no chance of getting in the hole.
Rodman defending Malone, and Malone swings it in. His first basket has 5 points in the game. Willie Anderson at 6'8", such a threat, and he slashes so well.
That's the strength of Willie Anderson's game, is driving the ball to the rim. Got a good bounce that time with the left hand.
All 5 Spurs starters have scored.
Whenever the Jazz get in trouble, they always go to Karl Malone, and he dominates the half-court set. They get Felton Spencer an easy two. Nice cut by the big guy.
And a good assist from Karl Malone. Quarter, the Spurs with a ball and a three-point lead. Del Negro over Spencer. Tipped in by Rodman. 6 for Rodman.
Delay of game.
Yeah. After the tip in by Rodman, someone, perhaps Rodman, touching the ball and delaying Utah's chance to move the ball up court. Malone high and then breaks low. Humphries to Karl Malone, way off the mark, and Robinson collects it. Anderson almost stripped by Hornacek. Robinson likes that shot and draws the foul. Malone's first. And with it, a timeout, 2:27 left in the first quarter.
Thursday night, Byron Scott's last-second three-pointer lifted the Pacers to victory in a 1-0 series lead. Now Shaq and company look to work their magic and draw even. Next on NBC.
Dennis Rodman, who brings two NBA championship rings with him to San Antonio, and considerable consternation, not only for opponents, but for coaches. And John Lucas had some second thoughts about the incident in game one.
I talked to my sister the other day. She said, "Now you don't grab nobody from the back like that. You grab them from the front." Well, the first time I grabbed it, I wasn't strong enough to hold him. When I found out he was going to get a flagrant foul, you only get four in the playoffs. At that time, I got to get him off the floor.
And you stay in your room until I let you come out. He loves his players, Lucas, and he has invited all kinds and types. So that is the true challenge of his job.
Hey, unconventional would be the word to describe the way that John Lucas looks at coaching in the NBA, and he wants players that are unconventional. Rodman, he really typifies that.
6 points now for David Robinson, and a 7-point lead San Antonio. Humphrey denied by David Robinson, who has four blocks already.
That perhaps explains why they're rushing everything inside, because David Robinson came flying out of the wing to knock that shot away. But Jay Humphrey thought he was in clean, and all of a sudden, David Robinson's there for the rejection.
Third in the NBA this year in blocks, and one of the reasons why San Antonio, second toughest to score against, next to the Knicks in the NBA.
Nice exchange that time as they cleared out David Robinson on the other side, and they give a give and go between Karl Malone and Jay Humphries.
Antoine Carr giving David Robinson a rest, and it's Carr, the veteran from Wichita State, out to Rodman for three. He said he was going to hit one. Utah basically does not guard Rodman out on the perimeter. Chambers into the game for the first time. Malone unable to connect. Here comes Rodman after his another rebound. Rodman. 8 points to lead San Antonio.
As much as a revolutionary figure as Dennis Rodman likes to paint himself, he understands basic basketball. Give and go. He gave it, went, got the two.
Malone unable to hit against Terry Cummings. Cummings, the surprise star of game one, with 18 points and 10 rebounds. Veteran from DePaul, who's had a serious knee surgery a year ago, and that has limited his ability to play, but certainly not his heart nor his influence. And that was the kind of game that really makes a coach happy, when a veteran comes in. It really was the difference in game one.
He played like the true warrior that he is. He knew that they needed some muscle. They needed somebody that could score inside. He added all that, bumped and banged John Stockton every time he tried to set that pick inside. So he knows what his role is in this series, and he's going to try to make sure that along with Rodman, they have some toughness out on the floor.
David Benoit replaces Spencer, and Miguel Knight in for the first time for San Antonio. Here's Knight with the ball, the former Phoenix Sun.
What the Jazz want to do right now is weather the storm. They haven't gotten any kind of offensive rhythm, but they've been able to stay in the game because of their defensive energy.
Cummings fights for the ball and beats two younger, shorter Jazz to it. Knight with 2 seconds. He scores, and it counts with a foul. Benoit with a foul.
A scrambling play. It looked like that Jay Humphries might be able to get to that ball and turn it into a break, but Cummings went to the floor. And that really made the difference in the reaction after the ball goes in. A little thump and bump.
The ex-Dayton Flyer, Miguel Knight, with a three-point play. And the biggest lead for San Antonio, 8 in the final seconds of quarter one. Good move by Humphries. Jay Humphries. He has 4. About 12 seconds difference between the game and shot clock. on Hornacek. Malone and a foul. Loose to ball Carr over the back. It is Carr, his first. So with just under 15 seconds left in the quarter, the Jazz go to the other end to shoot, and it'll be Malone at the line.
The free throw line has been a special friend for Karl Malone here in this first quarter because he has had trouble getting the ball in the basket from the field. He was terrific in game one and just can't find the rhythm. 1 for 9, but still able to get some points on the board for the Jazz.
Now 5 for 7 free throw shooting. As a rookie, shot under 50%, but has been in the 70s in recent years, but only 69% this season. And he misses a second, but Benoit jams it home on the follow. David Benoit with his first points. 24-20. And the Spurs apparently with the final shot. 8 seconds left in the quarter. Terry Cummings loses it to Benoit, and that's the end of the first period. Both teams having trouble scoring. Dennis Rodman, of all surprises, the leading scorer with 8, 4 for 5 shooting for Rodman, the rebounder, and the Spurs already up a game, lead by 4 after the opening quarter.
Welcome back to the Alamo Dome for the start of the second quarter. Hannah Storm with longtime Jazz center Mark Eaton, who's missed this entire season with a back injury. Mark, your team came out 1 for 16. They've kept their composure, but they're struggling offensively. Why?
Yeah, I think that San Antonio's made it very tough. I think we need to knock down a couple of outside jumpers to loosen it up a little bit, make it easier for Carl to operate inside.
San Antonio's getting a lot of easy layups. They could use you out there. Will you be back to play with the Jazz, or what's the status with your back?
I don't know. Sort of a remote chance at this point. My back is still bothering me, but definitely we need to take away some of those easy layups. You can't give up those.
Thanks, Mark. Best of luck to you in the future. Dick?
All right, Hannah, and Tom Chambers doing something he was unable to offer in game one, and that's make a field goal with the left hand. Pulls the Jazz within 2 to open the second quarter, 24-22. Although outshot dramatically in the first quarter, the Jazz are close. Miguel Knight connects.
The Jazz have to feel that they're going to get better at the offensive end and that they're into this ball game, and the pressure's on San Antonio to keep them from winning. Lob inside to Karl Malone. Big block.
Antoine Carr coming across to help out. Robinson over Malone. David Robinson, and suddenly it's a 6-point advantage. San Antonio, 8 points to the Admiral. Robinson, Benoit. Check that. Stockton, Benoit, Chambers, Malone, and Humphrey for Utah. Ellis, Knight, Cummings, Carr, and Robinson for the San Antonio Spurs as Humphrey hits the 3-pointer.
Now that's how you spell relief for Jerry Sloan, somebody making a basket, and that's a huge shot and a shot in the arm. Humphrey's off the bench with 7.
And it looks as if the Spurs have picked up an offensive foul underneath Cummings.
Karl Malone has great position, looks like he's going to get one clean, and that one's thrown away. Sloan just about to lose it as he comes back.
Looks as if they call a double technical. One on Malone.
Battling inside, the first shot was given by Terry Cummings. Malone gave him just a little push underneath, but the official saw 2 elbows.
Cummings got the offensive foul, and thus the ball to Utah. Chambers. Spencer with a push off against Robinson. It'll be San Antonio the other way. Spencer's first foul.
Utah number 80, Spencer. First team foul.
underneath. He has good position, but the ball bounced over his head. So he was locked up with David Robinson, an easy call for the official to make.
10 minutes to go, first half, 28-25 San Antonio.
Now, when Felton Spencer guards David Robinson, he looks to take the ball to the rim. He gets really aggressive.
Chambers with a rebound. Humphreys brings it in.
Very aggressive defense, forced a turnover.
And a pass by Robinson through the hands of Miguel Knight. But Stockton was there to make it difficult. Timeout, 9:30 left in the half, and John Lucas's Spurs by three.
The NBA on NBC is brought to you by the people at Nike, who encourage you to just do it. By Michelin, because so much is riding on your tires. And by American Honda, who has been making quality automobiles in America for the past 11 years.
On the beautiful waterway here in San Antonio, and we'll be switching to the City of Magic, Orlando. After this one, the NBA playoffs continue on NBC. The Indiana Pacers are Reggie Miller, Byron Scott and company up a game on the Orlando Magic and Shaq O'Neal. Game two of their opening round series. Pacers and Magic are coming up next on NBC. Dick Enberg with Steve Jones, Hannah Storm. The Spurs of San Antonio, a three-point lead, 28-25. 9 minutes plus remaining in the opening half. Benoit takes it down the hole.
Benoit is one of those players that needs to see the ball go in the basket. When it does, his game grows. That was a big shot to go in for him.
Spurs have led by as many as eight. Cummings. Not falling the way it did the other day, but falling out of bounds. Dale Ellis, who got bumped out by Chambers. Humphreys over Cummings. And Jay Humphreys gives Utah the lead. First time in the game that they've been in front. 9 points for Humphreys off the bench.
Humphreys is the unknown factor to this afternoon's ball game. He's got nine and been big here in the second quarter to get him on top.
13-4 run for Utah, and Miguel Knight is off the mark. Benoit out hustles Carr for the carom.
In a slowdown game, the Jazz are the better team because they're the better executing team. That's been the staple of their game for the Stockton-Malone era. Tom Chambers.
And Chambers makes it a 15-4 run. Dennis Rodman trying to get into the game, and now a timeout is called as Utah with its best spurt of this series. The Jazz by three. Back in the Alamo Dome, where Utah has claimed the lead 31-28 with 8 minutes left in this opening half. Dennis Rodman reappears. He has 8 points, but not happy because Steve Jones, all eight of those have come on twos. He's looking in terms of threes, suddenly thinks that he's a three-point shooter.
No, he's a specialist. He's not a shooter. He's a specialist, and he feels that he can knock him down.
Well, here's what Rodman promised for us in game two.
I'm going to nail it. If it ain't going to be the first, it's going to be the second. I'm going to nail a tray. And when I nail a tray, I'm pointing right at you. Okay? I'm pointing right at you, okay?
Yeah, he can do anything he wants as long as he's long distance and pointing. San Antonio needing someone to score. Cummings. Tonight, Stockton on him. Robinson with Chambers. Way short. Goes right back to Robinson, and he's fouled right at the buzzer. He beat the clock, and we'll get two. Benoit of a foul, his second. David Robinson in the six major statistical categories. Robinson finished in the top echelon, in the top 30. A rare feat. I mean, he led his team in assists. More assists, averaged almost five a game. while leading the league in scoring. That's a rather remarkable performance.
They changed the way that David Robinson plays center, and that's one of the reasons that his assist total has gone up so dramatically. Before, they were trying to play him at the post. He likes to face the basket, so they give him an isolation on the wing and then let him take the ball to the rim, see the floor, and that's where he finds the cutter.
The Admiral now with 10. Ellis with a steal. Did not please Jerry Sloan a bit. He went barking down on his bench as if to say, I don't want to see that. Ellis. Rodman unable to tip it home. Rebound Benoit, and Rodman all over him in the backcourt. Stockton. Many wonder why John Stockton doesn't shoot more. He led the Jazz in percentage, almost 53%. Many of those from outside, but he is so oriented at assisting and setting up the table for everyone else, he's reluctant to shoot. Foul underneath. Vinny Del Negro in, Miguel Knight out. Ball hit the bottom of the hoop.
Ball out on the side of the other official. Did he have a foul? And they're lining up like they got free throws to shoot, and the conversation will get cleared up as Jeff Kersey goes over to the scorer's table.
Yeah, where is that? Huh?
Now it's a matter of the shot clock, and 16 seconds is the time remaining.
J.R. Reed in the ball game for offense. Terry Cummings, who gave it to him in game one, not giving it to him this afternoon. So they're trying to find some punch to go along with David Robinson up front. They've gotten bonus points from Dennis Rodman.
Robinson, Chambers. Reed, who's averaging 9 on the season, threw it away. Humphreys with a loose ball. The Chambers. Del Negro to be blocked by Rodman, controlled by Reed. Reed knocked away by Humphreys, and a foul.
Tom Chambers thought he had a layup. Dennis Rodman hustling back denied him. In that turn, San Antonio loosed the other way, which resulted in J.R. Reed getting fouled. But turnovers was the story for the Utah Jazz in losing. Block shots may be the story for the San Antonio Spurs in winning this afternoon.
8-1 in this opening half as Reed has his first point, and this one to pull the Spurs within one. Pacers and Orlando Magic to follow this one on a big NBA weekend on NBC. In three games tomorrow, Spencer inside, over and through David Robinson. He has 4.
Now, Felton Spencer is on the sheet at about 265, but the real weight is closer to 300. And when he gets down there, that's a load for David Robinson to get away from the basket.
Robinson over Chambers. Fall. Rebound Benoit. Stockton hustles it into the offensive end. To Chambers. Can't connect. Spencer follows. And Utah enjoys its largest lead at 5.
Tom Chambers with a technical foul.
Thought he was fouled after being blocked by Rodman. Thought he was fouled that time. Thought he was fouled on that drive. And thought it, someone ran under him.
An emotional response from Tom Chambers right here at the rim. Yeah, he got undercut by Rodman, who came in with the hip, and the reaction cost him, but Vinny Del Negro doesn't cash.
Yeah, it did appear that Chambers had an argument.
I mean, we knew it was going to be physical, but
that might even have cost you 10 or 15 in the NFL.
That being diplomatic, he might have had enough.
Del Negro misses the technical. That's the poetic justice, didn't it? So 37-32, Karl Malone returns for Utah. They've taken the lead. In fact, rallied without the services of Malone. Knocked away by Stockton, controlled by Benoit. Yes. Jay Humphries.
Humphries has been huge. That is an added dimension, and Humphries has come out being aggressive at the offensive end, 7 1/4.
And a 20-second timeout by John Lucas there. Jay Humphries, 5 for 6, shooting off the bench, and 11 points to lead all scores. The veteran that was acquired from Milwaukee last year for Blue Edwards and Eric Murdoch.
The thing that was missing in game one was aggressive, tenacious play by the Utah Jazz. That is what they're giving this afternoon, and it's made a huge difference.
Turnovers uncommon for this Utah team. Only Cleveland turned it over less, and that's often a reflection of good point guards, Mark Price, John Stockton, and there's San Antonio third, which underlines our point that Vinny Del Negro perhaps doesn't get all the credit he deserves.
He certainly does, and he's done a terrific job, but you see the numbers are 10-4, and that means that the Utah Jazz are the aggressors in this ball game, and that's why they've gotten control of the scoreboard.
Utah 1 for 11 the first 4 minutes, and since then they're hitting 15-27. Robinson almost hit a tough leaner against two Jazz defenders. So we've gone from 8 points up San Antonio at 24-16 to 7 points up Utah. That swing in just a matter of about 7 minutes.
When you are the double team man, you have to recognize when the initial defender has the player under control. Felton Spencer came in when David Robinson was taking a tough try, ended up bailing him out.
Robinson misses his first free throw. And as it has been well documented, that Robinson won the NBA scoring title over Shaq O'Neal because of his superior free throw shooting. Had Shaq shot just 60%, he would have won the scoring crown. His brother, who is number one fan, Chuck Robinson, also attended the Naval Academy.
Trying to find Karl Malone, but they're taking a little bit too much time.
Rodman harassing Karl Malone. That's Felton Spencer, knocked by Reed out of bounds with 2 seconds on the clock.
2 seconds to shoot. 2 seconds.
They register that as another Robinson block, so he has 5.5. Stockton. Malone. Spencer. And Utah getting an inordinate number of offensive second and third chances.
That started at the outset of the ball game when they couldn't make the hoop. They continued to Felton Spencer. He's got 6.25, 2 consecutive putbacks for the big guy.
Utah 10 offensive boards, only 3 for the home team. Del Negro fires. Spencer beats Rodman to the rebound, clears it out to Stockton. They'll start over again. A two-man game, Stockton and Malone. And Malone touched it last. Willie Anderson returns, a starter for San Antonio, and Dale Ellis goes out.
Now they only got 2 points from Ellis. He came out looking to score, took 2 shots, hasn't seen a shot since then. So we'll see that San Antonio has reversed roles here in the second quarter, and that's why they're down 20%. Won't get it done. Won't even get it done in your driveway.
8-point lead for Utah as Reed from outside, way short. And Rodman can't rebound those when they hit the underside of the iron. So the two quarters have flip-flopped with San Antonio struggling to make a shot in the opening quarter and San Antonio on its home court unable to hit here in the second period. Humphries. Rebound, Benoit, another offensive board.
Benoit tonight, this afternoon rather, is very, very active at both ends of the floor. And if he can get another shot to go in, you can look for him to be all over the place. Malone yet to strike.
Benoit, another second chance. That's 12 offensive boards for Utah in the half. 8-point lead for the Jazz. Stockton into heavy traffic. 8 on the clock. Humphries for 3. Oh, my. Utah, 44-33. The biggest lead of the game for either team. 2 minutes to go.
2 3-point field goals for Jay Humphries. 10 in the quarter. He's got them up by 11. And they are breathing fire. The bench has dominated the game for the Utah Jazz.
Humphries, who averaged 7.5 a game through the regular season. Stockton hawking Del Negro, forces a tough shot. Robinson can't nail the tip, and here come the Jazz again. Stockton, oh, he scores and he's fouled. An incredible run by the Utah Jazz, and this is the kind of play that spurred them to 5 wins in 5 chances in the regular season.
Stockton with a little stop and go, and then he leaned in, had Del Negro going the other way, and the Jazz benches up, thumbs up.
21-5 run for Utah.
But for now, it's Bob Costas back in New York. Coming up on the Prudential Halftime Report, we'll look ahead to the second game of the doubleheader between Orlando and Indiana. The Pacers took the opener, as you know, on Thursday night. We'll hear from Indiana's Reggie Miller at halftime. He's never short on confidence, rarely at a loss for words. And Julius Erving and I will talk about the first half in San Antonio. Now the Jazz surprisingly lead it by 13 as we send it back to Dick Enberg and the Snapper.
All right, Bob, and there's the story, a pitiful one for those of you rooting for the Spurs. Only 9 points in this second quarter, outscored 26-9. John Lucas's team has missed their last 11 shots and find themselves down by 11 points, and Stockton trying to make it a dozen.
There's a clear example how offense is key to defense, and the Utah Jazz got the defense going, and their offense has stepped up, and they have control of the ball game here in the first half.
They got a 14-point lead now for Utah. 1.5 to go before the intermission. Just seems that San Antonio can't get a good shot. And Anderson misses. Benoit, another rebound. Malone running the floor and a foul. And I believe this one on David Robinson. Let's wait. Yep, it is. His second.
He got it early on the wing and had enough time to make an adjustment and see who the defenders were as he came barreling down the wing. A guy this size has set a standard for running the floor better than any power forward perhaps in the NBA ever. David Robinson collects the foul, but they have done this afternoon without Karl Malone having a big offensive day. In game one, he was the story, had no help from his friends. Today, his friends have pitched in big.
At 36 in game one in defeat, this is for his 9th point today. And another offensive rebound as Chambers tips it back out. A second chance, and that's been the story of the half for Utah. You can't get it done, well, we'll give you another try. Chambers for 3. Rebound Anderson. Final minute. First half, 48-33 Utah. Robinson, he even can't hit from short range.
Benoit has been snatching rebounds at both ends with one hand and really ripped that one off, so they're allowing the San Antonio Spurs just one look at it.
9 rebounds for Benoit, a reserve in this first half. Humphries. Oh, almost single-handedly, he's outscored San Antonio. He has 16 in this half, and he's outscored the entire Spurs team in the quarter.
12-9, but it has been real aggressive defense, and they have played mostly from the perimeter, haven't been getting any second chances. Rodman and Chambers hook up,
Chambers out of the game, but not Rodman. So Chambers goes, and Sloan right out there in that little melee, and he was ejected in game one. So with the lead, Tom Chambers in the final second and a half gets entangled with Rodman, and the early exit to the veteran Chambers.
And Tom Chambers and Jerry Sloan say, no way. He's the guy that went to the floor and got tossed down. We saw the end of it, and Chambers is saying, how can that happen? Jerry Sloan said, wait. You must be kidding.
Well, we didn't see the, what provoked it, and Chambers may have done something before he was thrown down by Rodman, perhaps an elbow that we didn't see on that replay. But Chambers is gone, leaves with 4 points.
We'll see if we can find it. The ball goes up right there. He got hooked in the head the first time when he delivered the retaliating blow. So, you know, that should have been something that canceled out.
Because he scored 2-1. It was Rodman who got more blows. If you're scoring at home, number of blows, Rodman wins that 2-1. Gets the fall and the TKO. Meanwhile, San Antonio has not scored a field goal in the last 10 minutes yes. and 48 and a half seconds. Almost shut out field goals for the quarter at home.
They had a similar game like that closing down the season against the Denver Nuggets. At home, they went 7-30 without getting a hoop, and it ended up costing them. So they are really in a quagmire right now. John Lucas is very studied, very concerned.
The all-time San Antonio playoff low for a quarter was 4 field goals. They scored only 2 in the second quarter today as Utah, down in the first quarter by 8 late, rallies and keeps right on running against the ice-cold San Antonio Spurs, the Jazz by 17 at halftime. Stay tuned for Bob Costas' Prudential Halftime Report after these messages.
This is the Prudential Halftime Report, brought to you by the Prudential. Peace of mind. It comes with every piece of the rock.
And it's halftime in San Antonio. The Jazz, who lost game one by 17, leading the Spurs by 17 at the half after outscoring San Antonio 30-9 in the second quarter. Bob Costas back along with Julius Erving. Doc, it started out like a nightmare rerun for the Jazz. Looking back to Thursday night when they shot so poorly, with the exception of Karl Malone, they missed 15 of their first 16 here, and the Spurs had a chance to run them out of the building.
This halftime score is unbelievable. The Spurs clearly had a chance to put the half away in the first quarter. Then they started missing shots, turning the ball over. Utah was a little shell-shocked. They weren't shooting well at all, and they started to believe in themselves. I think John Stockton has done a pretty good job of controlling the tempo, and the Jazz have gotten it from more places other than just Karl Malone. Felton Spencer's done a real good job offensive rebounding, putting the ball back in the hoop.
Jay Humphries with 16 points in the first half. Karl Malone, 8 points, 5 rebounds. David Robinson, 11 points, 8 rebounds, but to back up what you said, Doc, they missed, speaking of the Spurs, their last 14 shots of the half.
Yeah, they've taken some shots that are being contested by the Utah Jazz, and I think that's one of the keys, that the Jazz are really playing aggressive defense and contesting all those shots.
Okay, before we move on, a quick injury update. You may have seen the injury suffered by the Knicks' John Starks in last night's win at the Garden over the Nets. Starks drew an offensive foul on Johnny Newman, but hit the court hard, bruising his lower back. The word today from Knicks practice is that Starks was still icing the back, and a decision as to whether he'll play tomorrow won't be made until game time. A reminder about tomorrow's triple header on NBC. Note the start time, noon Eastern for us here in the studio with Showtime. Then it's the Knicks and the Nets with tip-off at 12:30 Eastern time from Madison Square Garden. The middle game of the three is Cleveland at Chicago. The Bulls won the opening game of that series last night. And finally, it's Weber and Barkley, the Golden State Warriors versus the Phoenix Suns. Phoenix up 1-0 in that best of five. And we've still got another game today, the Magic and the Pacers from Orlando. We'll hear from Indiana's Reggie Miller right after this message from Prudential and a word from the NBA. This is the Orlando Arena, and about an hour and a half from now, the Indiana Pacers will take on the Magic in Game 2 of that series. Now, the Pacers won the opener on Thursday night on the Magic's home floor as former Laker Byron Scott nailed a three-pointer with 2 seconds left. As usual, Reggie Miller played a big role for Indiana. He led the Pacers with 24 and hit several big shots down the stretch. Somewhat similar now to the way Dennis Rodman and Bill Laimbeer have become villains in many NBA arenas, or became in the case of Laimbeer. That's what's happening with Miller. Love him or hate him, he's become a star player in the NBA, and Peter Vesey talked with him.
People really misinterpret a lot of things I do on the floor because I am so loud. I do a lot of things that seem abnormal on the court. They think I'm the same way off the court. So when they approach me, they expect to see the same Reggie Miller that they see on the court. Off the court, now that's not the case. I'm just the opposite. You know, what I do for a living is what I do for a living. But when I'm away from basketball, I'm not like that.
So on the court, it's strictly show?
I think basketball is big entertainment. And we're just like any other rock star and musician. When Michael Jackson takes the stage, you know, lights are on, cameras are going, the moonwalk and all that. But, you know, away from there, you know, he's not like that. And I think that's what basketball is like. It's like big entertainment.
Reggie, you talk of yourself as an entertainer, mm-hmm. but there has to come a time when you have to back off that because this franchise has been mired in mediocrity. Mm-hmm. And having gotten out of the first round, when do you back off and place winning ahead of entertaining?
Well, I think we'd be putting a lot of pressure on ourselves to go out there and try to succeed to get past the first round. I think, if we, in the back of our minds, know that we're capable of doing this, then it's going to happen. You know, I kind of put the correlation between Michael and basketball. Sometimes you're going to have a bad album, but you got to come back strong, and I think that's what this team has done.
Here he comes, fade away. Yes, Miller hits a big one.
You enjoy being the villain.
Yeah, I think so. I think once Laimbeer left, I think I'm probably at the top of almost every stadium's list when I come into town. But it's nothing derogatory. I don't go out there to try to show people up. I go out there to try to get Reggie Miller into the game.
Do you want the fans to understand you?
No. I don't really care.
But you care if they misunderstand you?
Well, I mean, I enjoy going into, on the road, I enjoy going into a venue where you're not supposed to win. It's 12 versus 18,000, and everyone's on top of you, and everyone's booing you every time you touch the ball. That really excites me.
I think the public perception sometimes looks at him like he's a bad kid or a troublemaker or a selfish player. And when they pick the all-star teams and when they select the dream teams, I think a lot of people have an attitude about him because of that demeanor. And he's not like that. He's a good guy.
Maybe I've rubbed a couple general managers and coaches the wrong way by my play, but there's one thing that I always remember. Everyone hated Bill Laimbeer, but every coach and general manager loved to have him on his team.
Do you think your reputation as a villain or just your the way you act on the court, did that hold you back from getting the recognition and hey, you were the last guy chosen for mm-hmm. Dream Team 2?
Maybe so, but I'm not into all that. I'm not, you know, I don't need to have my name in headlines and be on every all-star and all that. I don't need that. Reggie Miller doesn't need that. As long as Reggie Miller goes out there and plays within the team confines and the team wins, then everyone benefits from that, not just Reggie Miller.
How long have you been on a first-name basis with Reggie Miller?
Well, I am who I am.
Yes, no dispute about that. That is an epidemic, by the way, athletes referring to themselves in the third person, not confined to basketball, but guys referring to themselves in the third
person. Somebody in the studio probably started that. One of the insiders probably, right?
You know, the Pacers have never won an NBA playoff series. We're ABA veterans, me as an announcer and you, of course, as the greatest player in the history of the league. And I guess there's a difference in those two standings, but nonetheless, the Pacers won 3 of the 9 ABA championships under Coach Bobby Leonard, but in the NBA, nowhere near as successful.
No, they haven't had the success, and you know, this is also a proud franchise, and the people of Indianapolis are rabid basketball fans. But getting back to Reggie Miller just for a second, you know, I don't know him that well at all, but I know he's, in the beginning of the season, I thought he was going to be one of the guys possibly leading the league in scoring. And then when I saw early where he was averaging 15 or 16 points a game while he was learning Larry Brown's system, I thought that there was something wrong there. I said, this is the first season without, first full season without Chuck Person. They traded for a defensive player and getting rid of Detlef Schrempf and picking up Derek McKee. Reggie's going to have a field day. But he's settled down. He's matured. He's the key to the mint for Indiana if they're going to do any damage in the playoffs offensively and with all of his aggressive defensive play, defensively as well.
All right, that's the second game of the doubleheader with Indiana playing at Orlando. Still another half left in San Antonio. It's Utah by 17, despite the fact that Malone is 1-for-12 from the floor. Robinson just 2-of-9 field goals. So the superstars not excelling in the first half with the Jazz leading 50-33. We'll send it back to Dick Enberg and Steve Jones after these messages from your local station.
This has been the Prudential Halftime Report, brought to you by the Prudential. Peace of mind.
A stunned San Antonio crowd here at the Alamo Dome, knowing that it can only get better. Their team not scoring in over 10 minutes of the second quarter, Steve Jones, and the 9 points, and no time in NBA history in the playoffs has a team scored as few as 9 points in the second quarter.
They don't want to hear that here in San Antonio, but that is their story. It was the aggressive, assertive play of the Utah Jazz in that second quarter of play as they dominated. They had some heroes that came off the bench, and they made big stories for Jerry Sloan.
As we said, it's sometimes the ones you don't plan on that really can hurt you in the playoffs. Let's take a look at the Miller Genuine Draft halftime statistics. David Benoit, part of that offensive rebounding force for Utah. He had 5 offensive boards, 8 total with his 4 points. Kept the ball alive for the likes of Jay Humphries, another reserve who had a brilliant first half, scoring 16 points, his high this year for Utah is 25 in a game. So the Jazz, despite the fact that Karl Malone was 1-for-12. Now, if you'd have said, called up your friend and said, hey, the mailman the first half was 1-for-12, how do you think the Jazz are doing? You'd feel that they'd probably be down by 17, not up by that amount. So Malone and the Jazz with a comfortable lead at halftime against David Robinson and the San Antonio Spurs. The second half tip-off coming up. Back at the Alamo Dome, Utah by 17. Hannah Storm is with the San Antonio head coach.
Thanks, Dick. Luke, to put this in perspective, it was the worst shooting quarter in Spurs playoff history, also the lowest scoring. What happened to your offense in the second quarter?
We really got bogged down. They really shut us down, and they made David have to move the ball. We took some bad shots. We got to get some other people to come in the game. Their bench really hurt us.
You are also getting out-rebounded by 10. How much of a concern is that?
That's a big concern. They're just out-hustling us right now.
All right, Coach, better luck in the second half.
Thank you.
Dick?
And we're ready to go for the second half. It'll be Stockton and Humphries, Corbin, Spencer, and Karl Malone for Utah, Rodman, Robinson, Anderson, Ellis, and Del Negro, the opening starters for San Antonio.
At this end of the floor, let's see if John Lucas has lit a fire under his team and they get more aggressive and make it difficult for Malone and teammates to score.
Humphries for 3. Misses his first attempt, and Rodman embraces the rebound. Robinson. Spencer able to position himself, get it away from Rodman. Stockton. Yeah, the shot, passed it up. Humphries, Corbin, Robinson.
Jerry Sloan starting to tie Corbin and really would like to see him get something going in this ball game at the offensive end. He's a slashing, attacking type of player who has to have wide open jump shots, can't get it done.
Ellis with the runner. Rodman rebounds. That's his 8th. Can't score, and Karl Malone. Stockton, Malone, was he having a tough time? But he had it out to Stockton.
He had to adjust because suddenly there was David Robinson and he put it up with the left hand, but they've done what they has made them successful. Offensive rebound, keep it alive.
Spencer, and a foul by Rodman, and the ball drops for Utah. This is getting ugly for San Antonio fans. Second foul on Rodman.
Rodman got a rare offensive rebound, couldn't get it done, and you watch, he hugs Karl Malone and then won't let him go. That's why players get really irritated with Rodman.
Felton Spencer, and a fine role player in Utah, the seven-footer from Louisville, a number one pick of Minnesota. Trade last June for Mike Brown. He was Timberwolves.
He was considered a non-center with the T-Wolves, so that means he was not a very effective player. Put him on a good team, and suddenly he's more effective here this afternoon. 11 points, but a lot of offensive rebounds for Felton Spencer.
San Antonio has missed 17 shots in a row. 18. Unbelievable. 20-point lead, Utah. Spencer. And Dale Ellis gets the loose ball. You can hear the frustration in this Alamo Dome crowd. Ellis fouled by Humphreys. His second.
San Antonio needs to find a hot hand right now. David Robinson is struggling as much as Karl Malone is, but there has been no one to step up in a white uniform that's been able to strike a match, see the ball consistently go in. They'd like to see this guy get it done, Dale Ellis, because he has tremendous range and can bring him back in a hurry with three-point shooting.
Veteran from Tennessee misses the free throw. He was the number two scorer for John Lucas on the regular season, behind Robinson, averaging 15 a game, has only two today. Bronx cheer from these San Antonio fans, finally getting the free throw. 13 minutes without a field goal, San Antonio.
Some of that is very good defense and part of bad offense.
Malone with a power move, and Karl Malone only his second field goal. 10 points for the mailman. Now a 21-point deficit staring at San Antonio.
David Robinson,
holding his right knee, and that looks bad. Robinson holding his right knee as he crumpled in pain on the near sidelines. Let's hope that that's not serious.
David Robinson had to go to the floor to try to make a save. He is sandwiched by three Utah Jazz. Malone, Stockton, Felton Spencer all come around, and now as he comes out, he rolled over and seemed to have twisted the knee.
If we look at it again, I think it happened on his fake move. As he made his fake move, watch the right knee. If we'll go back, see it a second time. At least he's on his feet and seems to be putting full power on it. And Hannah Storm will scurry to that end of the court and give us a complete report as to its possible seriousness. As if on the fake move at the start, and then afterwards, when Stockton rolled on it, was after the fact.
He lost his footing on that initial move.
Right there. I don't think it had anything to do with the fact that Stockton was around him. Del Negro hits the free throw. 55-35. They're just joining us. San Antonio just cannot find a way to score a field goal at home. So the fans are left with cheering free throws.
This is one of those games where they have to say your defense has to be consistent because you're not getting it done at the offensive end. Let's see if the Spurs can become the aggressors that they were in game one and take Utah away from what they want to do.
Humphreys Humphries for three. Oh, down the bottom of the well from long range. Just as hot as Humphries is, frigid are the San Antonio Spurs, who have now not scored for what amounts to a quarter and 2 minutes, 14 minutes without a field goal.
And you know that they're a very limited team with David Robinson off the floor. Rodman with the putback.
20 shots in a row now missed by San Antonio. That'll be a jump ball, Spencer and Rodman. Again, 20 shots, no hits for San Antonio over 14 minutes without a field goal.
It's unbelievable, and particularly when you have the leading scorer in the NBA on your team, you'd have figured you'd have found some cheap way to get one.
And in part, testimony to the fact that Utah has contested every shot. There have not been any easy attempts for the Spurs. Malone. Ellis gets the rebound. 8 minutes to go. A lot of work to be done for the home team. Ellis blocked by Spencer. Anderson takes it deep. Cummings with seven. Stolen by Corbin. To Stockton. Stockton with 11.
The Utah Jazz, they run on opportunities, and after the turnover, they get an easy two, and they continue to build on the lead. 36 points in three quarters of play.
Way off, not even close for Ellis, out of bounds to San Antonio. Hannah Storm with a report on David Robinson.
Well, Dick, David was just looked at by team doctor David Schmidt. It seems that when he twisted the knee, he actually sprained that right knee. But as you see, he is coming back in the game. He should be fine. Keep in mind, this is the right knee that gave him a lot of problems last year and that he had surgery on after they exited from the playoffs last season, Dick.
Thank you, Hannah, and it's good news. So Robinson back in. 22 shots in a row without a connection, and Stockton called for the block, his second foul.
Utah number 12, John Stockton, his second.
You'll hear Jerry Sloan saying constantly, put a body on him, put a body on him, and that's what the Utah Jazz have done this afternoon. They have had their bodies on the white-shirted Utah Jazz, and they have surrounded David Robinson.
Lloyd Daniels, he comes off the bench hoping he has some magic. Out of bounds, last touch by Humphries. So the last time that San Antonio scored a field goal, there was a minute and 7 seconds gone in the second quarter. A minute seven. We're now 7-11 left in the third. Robinson gets stuck and refuses to drop. Let's have an inspection. Call time and look at that basket. There must be some invisible wires.
David Robinson on the throwdown, so he picks up his third personal foul. John Lucas has got to come up with something on that little chalkboard that says 2 points.
He's going to have his team in heavy overcoats, Alaskan garb, if they don't warm up soon.
NBA Inside Stuff, Saturdays on NBC. The NBA on NBC is brought to you by cold-filtered Miller Genuine Draft. Get out of the old, get into the cold. By Xerox, the document company. See your documents differently. See your business differently. And by Mitsubishi, the new thinking in automobiles.
And welcome back to the Alamo Dome. David Robinson and the Spurs. There's the epitaph. 3 seconds shy of a 16-minute field goal drought. They're 0 for 10 here in the second half. Under 7 minutes to go, and Utah outscoring the Spurs 10-3 here in the third quarter, building a 60-36 lead.
If San Antonio's going to get into it, they've got to start right now. They've got to make the Jazz a scoreless team. Felton Spencer not going to have any of that. He's been a big story this afternoon.
13 for Spencer. 9 rebounds as well for the big guy. The bench for Jerry Sloan has just been outstanding. Robinson tipped in by Rodman. Is it going to count? Yes, and a foul.
Basket and strike.
That ended a string of 25 attempts.
At last, that's what they're saying. David Robinson couldn't have had a better look when Rodman on the inside gets the tip and gets the foul, so he'll have a chance for a three-point play. But they're going to need a lot more of those, and they're going to have to see the Utah Jazz go dead in the water in order to get in it.
I don't know if the NBA keeps a record of that sort, but it'd be interesting to see if anyone in NBA playoff history has gone 16 minutes and 25 seconds without a field goal.
Forget the NBA history in the playoffs. How about just a regular game? I mean, that is a long, long drought.
You couldn't try to miss and go that way. Humphreys gets the roll. And Jay Humphreys leads all scorers. Tony,
this is a classic example of a team game. Their primary offensive weapon is Karl Malone. He's having a bad performance himself, but it's been Humphreys, Benoit, Spencer that have picked up the load, and they had Utah in control of the game.
San Antonio knows it's not going to get much better when they go to Salt Lake City, where the Jazz play so well at home. Rebound, Rodman. Miguel Knight, stolen by Humphreys, but right back to Daniels on the blind pass.
3 seconds. Look at the Jazz reactor. They're reacting to everything, and it is just going to be one of those days that David Robinson won't want to remember. This is not going to be like the 71-point game.
2 for 14. It's the antithesis of the 71. Both the star centers, Malone and Robinson, having a very difficult day, but Karl Malone's supporting cast, Jay Humphreys included, has been brilliant. Malone steals another offensive rebound, and it goes against Malone, or was he out of bounds?
When he got the ball, ball hit the inline, so it's a turnover. Sleepy Floyd comes in the ball game. You know you're looking for some real hard defensive energy from him.
Willie Anderson out, the veteran Floyd, who doesn't see much playing time these days. 34 years old, his 12th season. Out of bounds on the turnover to Utah. Hey, Lucas Lavel put himself in. He might activate himself. He works out with his team.
And the way he's looking at Miguel Knight, he's trying to get him to understand. When you see him penetrate, we want you to slide so he's got a passing angle. Otherwise, you end up with a turnover. Hornacek, who's not been a factor in this game, is back in.
Stockton giving a breather. In the hole to Malone. Blocked by Robinson, but a foul. Rodman and Robinson double-teaming Karl Malone. It's Rodman who gets his third foul. Just take a look at that. That's a picture that you're not going to see very often in any NBA or any college encounter, for that matter.
Go down one more step. Maybe not even in high school.
Single digits for the home team, mind you, in the second and possibly the third, although they got 4.5 minutes to do something. Malone 2 for 17 from the floor and 7 for 11 from the line. And your star scorer has that kind of off day, 2 for 17, and you can still be ahead.
Down 27. You see how Karl Malone leans back on that free throw. That's what's causing him to miss. Wonder if anyone's going to help him with that correction.
Knight to Robinson, and a foul. Appeared to be Ty Corbin, his first. Here comes Benoit back in for the Utah Jazz, one of the stars of the first half. Now, and they say, hold off here, David.
Whether you lose by 1 or 100, a loss is still a loss. That's what John Lucas was trying to tell his team. So our 17-point victory means nothing if the Utah Jazz come in here and get a game this afternoon. That's all they came down here for, was to get one of two. And so far, the Jazz are on track.
Felton Spencer out, Benoit in. Robinson misses his second free throw. He's 7 for 9. That gives him 12 points in the game. 8 of them on free throws. The visitors from Utah by 26. Humphreys takes it in. Oh, 23 for Jay Humphreys. That's only 2 under a season high. He's outscored the entire San Antonio team the last 2 quarters.
But notice how Utah has reacted defensively. They've been after everything, and then they're limiting to 1 shot, and now they've become a fast break team.
And Humphreys hits again to match his season high of 25. A 36-7 run for the Jazz. I mean, well, that's a gallop.
Even from, even from the floor, though, it is a pesky Jay Humphrey. He is after everything. Knock down, kick, trip, do anything, but don't let him get anything cheap.
Humphreys, who grew up near the Laker home, the L.A. Forum, as you watch him hustle here against Knight.
Now watch, there's a leg whip. You're not going anywhere. I'm going to make sure that we have some sort of contact, and all they're doing is giving the San Antonio Spurs one at a time.
Knight with a 6-point back to Humphreys. He saw his first playoff action at the Forum with the Lakers working as a vendor. He was selling. And boy, they're the Lakers that he used to cheer as a kid watching today must say, hey,
we could have used him.
This year they could. Back underneath the Monroe and foul, I believe, on Rodman. No, it's Robinson, his 4th with the body.
They had an exchange where they get the guard to screen for Karl Malone, and the guard steps out to shoot the jump shot. They smothered that, and then they dropped the ball in. Malone had the angle. David Robinson pulled him off the ball.
New 24.
Telling Sleepy Floyd, you got to dress up. You can't have your shirt hanging out, and that's what the delay of game was, as he gets a uniform in trout.
Humphreys to Malone on the switch, and Karl Malone, you could see he wanted that one. He was jumping up high, helping it home. 30-point lead, the biggest of the game, and finally, Miguel Knight. Was it long 2? 2:45 left in the 3rd quarter. You could see it in the Utah eyes yesterday as we talked to them. They had really been whipped by Jerry Sloan, who was very unhappy with their aggressiveness, their hustle in game 1, and they've come out and played back the kind of game, as Knight unable to get it to drop. They played the kind of game that was delivered to them in game 1 from San Antonio. Timeout. 2:26 left in the 3rd. All Utah. And San Antonio coach John Lucas yesterday was prophetic. He says, even in the middle of the night, you wake up and you know it's always some guy you hadn't thought about that'll beat you. That's happened today.
A guy who is least expected to do some positive. Terry Cummings was a guy for us, and the next day it may be someone else. And that's what the key is to the whole playoffs. Somebody you didn't prepare for always beats you.
One of those somebodies right there with 25 to lead all scorers. Jay Humphreys, 11 for 15 here in game 2 to match his season high.
Normally, you would say if they could get the game down 2, that's such a long way to go down 2, that what the San Antonio Spurs should be playing the next 14 minutes for is preparation for game 3. And John Lucas has now got to get that emotional spark and fire back that they had in game 1.
Robinson is the leading San Antonio scorer with 12. That's 11 now for Miguel Knight. Now, usually you say, well, first let's get it under 20, then let's get it to single digits. Well, they're still 71-45, 26 down. Approaching 2 minutes left in the third.
The first two games have been a struggle for Jeff Hornacek offensively. They're going against the clock now.
Karl Malone has hit two in a row. And the mailman now has posted 15.
Under two.
36 in game one to lead all scorers. How about Charles Barkley last night? 36 and down the stretch it was Barkley who wanted and delivered for the victory over a very talented, exciting young Golden State team. We'll be seeing them tomorrow. Knight not there. Benoit rebounds for a moment. Then has it taken by Cummings and Hornacek steals the pass.
And the Jazz have just come up with all of the loose balls and the hustle plays that make the difference between winning and losing. And that Benoit has been a big factor in that from the second period on.
Malone against Cummings. Just squeezes along the baseline. Three in a row for Carl.
But now he's calmed down. David Robinson sitting down for sure. And I'm sure John Lucas is saying, David, you can't have any impact on this game. And they want to make sure his knee is okay. So Carl Malone is freewheeling.
Now into the final minute of the third. 30-point deficit. Cummings aggressively to the hole and the foul on Karl Malone. His second.
Karl Malone is great at using his body and holding position. He's gone before Cummings can react, and that's the reason that he's able to get that two. He was away from him before he could ever get a body on him. And at this end of the floor, Karl Malone picks up a foul, but the Jazz are contesting everything. Malone jumps out on a switch. Hornacek jumps back in. Benoit steps in the way. And they're getting everybody alert and active at the defensive end.
First point for Terry Cummings today after his 18-point, 10-rebound effort in game one.
The crowd is saying, put David Robinson back in. Lucas said, look, this is a five-game series. We may need all five. We got to keep David Robinson around.
49 seconds. Stockton, hawked by Floyd, finds Benoit.
Ty Corbett's not even looking to score the ball, and right now there's no pressure on him. This is not a tight game.
Rodman with a beautiful block out of bounds with 3 seconds on the clock.
3 seconds.
Catch and shoot.
Hornacek. Rebound Cummings. 4-on-1 break. Daniels. Lloyd Daniels, his first points. Only the third field goal in almost two full quarters.
The Jazz would have to be into a turnover, a ratio that would be unparalleled in one quarter of play as the crowd tries to get the Jazz defense in it.
2 second difference in the clocks. Corbin and another offensive rebound. No, out of bounds on the baseline. 1.9 seconds. Well, you got to hand it to these fans in San Antonio. They're certainly trying to help their team. Floyd, last second throw. And like so many efforts, much closer than that one. Way off the mark. Karl Malone and David Robinson, and Malone hitting three in a row late here in the third quarter, outscoring the Admiral by five. But the story is in big bold print, 75-49 into three.
This copyrighted telecast of the National Basketball Association may not be retransmitted, reproduced, or rebroadcast without the express written consent of the NBA.
Listen to these fans at the Alamo Dome. You've got to give them top scores for their support. Although San Antonio has not offered much for which to cheer. In fact, the NBA record book shows that 27 is the lowest scoring half in playoff history. If you combine the second and third quarters, in essence a half, 25. Lloyd Daniels hits a three.
One thing Jerry Sloan is going to remind his team, you can't go to sleep. At the other end of the floor, Terry Cummings trying to get aggressive, picks up the foul against Stockton. The Jazz, when they have the lead, are a difficult team to come back on if they're not making mistakes and self-destructing because of their ability to execute, because of Karl Malone's ability to get to the free throw line.
Well, they were, as we already told you, second in the league in least turnovers, and they were first in the league in least steals. So they protect the ball as well, if not better, than anyone. Almost through the hands of Spencer and into the basket. And another foul on Cummings. He calls himself the enforcer. Robinson's the captain. He said, but even though I'm not playing much, I'll be the enforcer. They still respect me.
They got a lucky break. The ball hits the rim, and then Felton Spencer even got a better break. And when it's going bad, that's the kind of reaction you get. He lost the ball. How could I foul him when he didn't even have it?
points for the former athletic and academic star at Louisville, who had an A average in broadcasting while playing for the Cardinals. Graduated the top 5% of his class, did Felton Spencer.
What Jerry Sloan said about him, he's a peach of a guy to have on the team, and what he'd like to do is see him be able to use his size and weight a lot more effectively. He's done it this afternoon.
15 for Spencer. Sleepy Floyd hits his first shot. Floyd, and perhaps the last year of his outstanding NBA career.
Think these fans here were ahead by 23, but they are hoping that Dallas Noise will get the defense inspired, but it goes quiet with that Stockton hoop.
Stockton, who had 3 in game 1, 13 in game 2. Cummings. Rodman. Rodman's 3. Spencer with a rebound. 12 rebounds for Felton Spencer and 15 points. So what a bench play for Utah. Spencer, Humphreys with 25 points. Benoit with double figure rebounds. Many of those on the offensive end. Stockton hit the court hard and still almost stole a ball from his knees. Daniels for another 3. You don't score anything for 2 quarters. A couple of 3s will bring pandemonium.
And you know what they're all saying? Why wasn't he in earlier, John? How come he didn't have the game? Lloyd Daniels picks up the foul.
Daniels playing for a new daughter born in this past week.
Lloyd Daniels is a terrific spot-up shooter. They let him set his feet, and it's 2 in a row, and the crowd, they're going a little crazy, thinking there's a comeback.
9:31 left.
Miller Genuine Draft presents Genuine Moments.
Today's Miller Genuine Draft Miller Moment takes us back to April 1978. San Antonio's ice, George Gervin, locked in a season scoring duel with Denver's David Thompson. It would come down to the final day of the regular season, and Gervin would win the title. Last Sunday, David Robinson battling with Shaquille O'Neal for the scoring crown, unleashed 71 points to not only capture the scoring championship, but in the process passed George Gervin's Spurs record of 63 in a game of April 78. In recognition of this moment, Miller Genuine Draft donates $1,000 to the Thurgood Marshall Scholarship Fund. And Robinson moving up on the Wilt Chamberlain elite list. And in fact, 71 in a game. Let's see, that's 14 more than the entire team has scored today.
And they always say save some. Yeah. Couldn't you have saved some for today? And they could go up to Utah 2-0.
You know what Lucas said, though? He thinks he could score 100 in a game. He said that with a straight face. He said, if he just gets greedier like me, he could score 100. Nine on the shot clock. Stockton, Malone gets Rodman in the air, doesn't get a call.
He was thinking foul all the way and ended up shooting an air ball.
Sleepy Floyd. Loose ball. Malone, great play off the back of Daniels. It goes to Utah. Malone alertly knowing he's going out of bounds, just fired it off the back of Daniels.
This typifies the afternoon for the Jazz. Malone beat Lloyd Daniels to that ball and then had the presence to throw it off him to make a save to keep the ball in the Jazz's hand. Lloyd all over John Stockton.
Less than 9 minutes to go. Malone takes it in himself. 79-57 Utah. San Antonio started as if they were going to repeat the great effort of game one, led by as much as eight in the final minute of the first quarter. And then it is as if somebody drew a curtain on them the next two quarters.
John Stockton went over to Ed Rush and said, you know, you got to get this Sleepy Floyd off me. He's wearing me for a blanket. See if that little politicking did any good, and he gets a whistle.
Five fouls now on Cummings. Miguel Knight reappears.
Well, you won't have to worry about it. Coach Lucas took him out. But Sleepy Floyd was trying to give him some defensive energy.
New 24 after the foul. Stockton. Into Malone. The old 1-2 punch for almost a full decade. Back to Stockton, blocked by Rodman. He's had a bunch and Stockton is hurt.
This is a terrific reaction block by Dennis Rodman, and on the way down catches a piece of John Stockton.
And Jerry Sloan, protecting his man Stockton, gets a technical foul. He got two in game one. He's always up there among the leaders. That's his style. He's a fighter, was as a player, one of the great defensive backcourt players in the history of the NBA. In fact, he's the only number retired by the Chicago Bulls as number four.
He's a true grit guy. He believes in hard work, gets it done all the time. And he's one of those guys that will fight you for everything. So officials have never been friends of his.
This year, Mike Dunleavy of Milwaukee, when you lose as many as Mike did, you tend to get more. And Sloan actually down there with only 11, a quiet season. Lucas beat him. He's got three in the playoffs. Well, Rodman gets a lot of technicals, but he creates them too, doesn't he?
Yeah.
Stockton. Malone, another offensive rebound.
Now they have their three small guards in the ball game: Hornacek, Stockton, and Jay Humphries, and they'll work with Malone and Felton Spencer.
Illegal defense to call on San Antonio. They had a warning in the first minute or so of the game, so that'll be a technical. If we get a chance, we showed you earlier in our telecast. Stockton in game one entangled with Robinson as he set up a pick. And it's a part of this game that not many play anymore, and much less a guy that's 6'1", 175. We'll get the comments perhaps from his coach Sloan in full admiration of Stockton if we have an open break here along the way. It's something, if you can take your eyes off the ball and just watch Stockton after he gives up the ball, what he does. Kind of an interesting part of this game, tough part of this game.
And he's an irritant to those big people because, one, you're not supposed to be setting the screen. Nice steal, Dennis Rodman.
That gets the Spurs within 20.
The crowd has not given up. They're looking for a miracle right now. What the Jazz have to do is remember to be aggressive at the offensive end. They want to use as much time in each possession, but they got to come up with good shots every time.
Stockton inside to Malone. Karl Malone now with 19.
Now he's going to grind his way to 20. but they're going to make the San Antonio Spurs remember this afternoon.
Malone told us he has 6 fouls. If he has to use them, he's willing to spend. That's his third.
They're not letting anyone come into the lane without paying a penalty as he wraps up Miguel Knight.
This, at playoff time, is a man's game.
Yeah, you got to have some heart to come down the lane knowing that you're going to take a shot. That means you also have to maintain some concentration. But that's where the game is won, in the high percentage area, and the team that's going to deny you a chance to get in there.
Knight now leads San Antonio with 13 points.
David Robinson obviously threw for the day. Twisted a knee. Not considered serious. Finished with 12.
82-62. Biggest comeback in the playoffs. Fourth quarter deficit is 16 points.
So if San Antonio digs out of this, it'll be an incredible mark.
Rodman. And Jerry Sloan did not like at all the fact that Rodman kind of threw a wild swing in there, and that will be a flagrant foul. And now a technical, no, a timeout call by Jerry Lucas. John Lucas. A lot of whistles, a lot of signals here. Whether it's timeouts, technicals, we'll sort it out.
You see the shot to the head. There's no question. He just took a free swing. Karl Malone took a wheel.
And we have a timeout.
Folks, coming up after the Jazz finish off the Spurs, we've got the Pacers and the Magic from Orlando. If Orlando doesn't win today, it could be the last time this season that Shaq laces up those size 22 ground pads at home. They would be down 0-2 if the Pacers win again today, with games 3 and 4 scheduled for Indiana. So, though it's a cliche, it is a nearly must-win situation for Orlando coming up in game 2 of the doubleheader. Right now, back to the Alamo Dome as we rejoin Dick Enberg and the Snapper.
Thank you, Bob. It's 82-62, 20-point lead. Here's Rodman. Boy, sky high when he comes down.
That's the reason that you have the flagrant foul. He made no attempt to make a play on the ball and just delivered a blow to the head. Karl Malone wisely wheeled. He's thinking, well, I'm going to get 2 free throws anyway because I got him up in the air. But he has his second flagrant foul of the playoffs. You can only have 4 before you get a 1-game suspension. That's a concern of John Lucas. So he's got to monitor him the rest of the way. And Rodman is over there talking to Jerry Sloan.
And it's cumulative. If San Antonio advances into the playoffs, only 2 to spend for Rodman. Hey, Sloan knew how to play hard and tough.
Right.
He can understand to a point. Malone uses all of the rim on both free throws and now has 21 points.
Rodman works everybody. He's working the opposing coach, telling him, look, you know, I'm not down here trying to play unfair or get an unfair advantage, but he led the league in flagrant fouls.
And has had 1 in each of the first 2 games of the playoffs.
Trying to give a message to a team, San Antonio, that was considered by some as a little soft a year ago. Humphreys not there. Malone. Still another offensive rebound, and Stockton wide open for the score. Offensive rebound, certainly a big part of this story. 19-10 in favor of Utah.
The will to win is just as important sometimes as the skills to win. And the Utah Jazz had the will this afternoon. They have made all of the hustle plays. Big play by Dennis Rodman.
Dennis Rodman with 12 points and 16 rebounds. And other things that won't show up on the score sheet. Boy, how quick was that? Karl Malone, that quick step and another easy 2. So after a terrible first half, Malone coming to life here in the second.
Oh, all of these points now come with David Robinson out off the floor, so it's easier for him to get inside and score those points.
Daniels hits another three. So he's 3 for 3 from three.
How long Jerry Sloan will stay with Malone and Stockton. And there's Rodman and Hornacek becoming entangled. Gonna have to get a fire hose out here to wash them apart.
The guard set the screen for the Utah Jazz. Hornacek said, I got an elbow in the chin. I'm not letting you go, however. And Dennis Rodman picks up the foul. So, and now the question really is, how long will John Lucas let Rodman stay out here in this situation? He's battling everybody, the officials, the opposing players, and it's becoming very frustrating for him.
Hornacek, 2 for 2, his only points of the game. The league's top free throw shooters.
Well, that'll rate a call from his dad for sure.
Yep. He says my dad called me this year and said, hey, you missed a free throw, huh? He said, Dad, give me a break. I'm shooting 89%. I will miss one now and then. I'm in the top 5 in the league.
But his dad, a high school coach, still coaching, has that right to be able to critique.
Lead, another whistle. Hornacek gets his third foul.
Trying to free up Lloyd Daniels.
Rodman back outside to Floyd. Here's Knight for two. That might be a push off on Stockton into the back of Cummings. His third.
Now in those, not in the heavier weights, but the lighter weights, you know, we don't get the knockout boxing. The fighters come out of there and they've got all these red marks on their face. That's how Stockton looked after game one. Looked like he'd gone 15 rounds.
And it didn't look like he was a winner at all. I mean, from the calf up on the left side, he was reddened and he had really taken some shots.
Rodman's still battling, especially that's his average, 17 rebounds. Cummings reverses and scores his 4th point. Back to a 20-point game. 4.5 minutes left. And it's quite apparent they'll go to Salt Lake City, a game each, and the Jazz with 2 home wins, and they've been very dominant at home, would be the team to advance. And remember, during the regular season, they won all 5 of the games with San Antonio.
John Lucas on more than one occasion has said this about his team. They can't stand success, and they have to be a team that plays with their backs against the wall. They're putting themselves in that situation once again.
Like to play out of fear, he says. I want him to be afraid. 17 now for Stockton.
And it's obvious this afternoon that we're not playing out of fear.
Yeah, we had the comment he made. He was right on target. He said, you know, we had this easy win after everyone said, oh, you can't beat Utah. We beat him by 17 in game one. And right away, that coach is saying, the coach speaks it. Ed, he said, but if they come back and beat us by even a 1 point, doesn't matter about game one. I want my team to still be afraid. Rodman. He's had a big scoring game for him. 14 points. In fact, for Rodman, that equals his season high. Rodman goes down hard.
Delivered a blow to John Stockton.
Oh, Sloan, man. Sloan would like to take off his coat and challenge Rodman head on. He wants a timeout, and he's ready to fight himself, Sloan. He says, you're going to maim my players. And that's the penalty that Stockton gets, and he feels he was cheap shotted. And this This is, I look at Stockton. He can't believe that a fellow professional would nail it.
Watch the hip right there, and he gets him down low, right around in the hip area, and that usually turned out to be a hip pointer, and that's a real painful injury, difficult to run. You can't really stand a hit right now, and John Stockton, he's writhing in pain.
Could be a costly victory for both sides.
The NBA on NBC is brought to you by New Ice Brewed Ice Draft from Budweiser. Taste the future of draft beer. By Craftsman Lawnmowers and Tractors, only at Sears, bringing America's best to you. And by Oldsmobile.
Let's go back to the Stockton injuries, Snapper.
All right, John Stockton is going to make a cut right in here, and if you can watch this little subtle knee, of Dennis Rodman, will clear it, and you'll watch Rodman come out. If you stop it right there, you'll see that leg come out, and that's where John Stockton goes over, and we'll find out the extent of the injury.
He's willing to take it. He hands it out. But he's willing to take it, and he's challenging verbally Rodman, who's looking back at him. And technical foul here, I believe, on Sloan, and that'll be twice he's thrown out, or is it Rodman?
Rodman.
Yeah, I think, in a way, the officials knew they missed the ball, and they were looking for any kind of eruption at all from Rodman. It'll be a taunting technical. And it was a way of making up for something they didn't see.
And Lucas is saying, just go to the dressing room. Don't say anything to anybody. Just get in there. And on the way out, he has something to say to the Jazz.
Now, you wouldn't want to hang around too long around that Utah bench. There are a few folks over there that were ready to stand up for Stockton. 14 points, 17 rebounds, and 4 blocks. Couple of technical fouls for Dennis Rodman.
There are some things that you can tolerate and some things you can't. And in a game where you're ahead by 20, 22 points, you don't expect to see a knee come out on a cutter. And that's why John Stockton is really unhappy challenging him. And guaranteed, he will try to get Dennis Rodman back.
Hannah Storm has a report on John Stockton.
Thanks, Dick. I've just talked to Dr. Lyle Mason. He says that Stockton was kneed in the thigh area just above his knee. They're icing it now. They put some freezing spray on it. He said it could be stiff for a while, and he might not be able to practice, but he does anticipate that John Stockton should be ready for the game Tuesday in Utah. Dick?
Yeah, they're almost like father and son. He's a real Papa Sloan, isn't he?
They're tough guys, and John Stockton broke his leg and tried to play on that leg for the Dream Team, so it tells you that the guy has a high pain threshold, so if he can walk, he'll be playing on Tuesday. 2 free throws, that means there's going to be more than one call. There's going to be father flying out there to Utah, and we're going to work on your technique, Jeff.
This is really unusual for Hornacek, who hits 1 out of 2 and is 5 for 7 in the game. 5 points, all 5 on free throws. Jack Healy, usually in the final minutes of games that are either going to be big wins or big losses, a huge favorite here in San Antonio. Played at UCLA. He's a solid team player and cheerleader and good practice player. Technical foul on Lucas, I believe. Well, it's had its share of that. The T word, the T sign has been in capitals in San Antonio. That's the 7th technical in the game. Plus another for an illegal defense, so 8 technicals have been called. Snapper, you're next.
they usually don't come over here, but
there's some officials that have kicked out announcers.
Oh,
And even the hardiest of these wonderful fans in San Antonio have huckled up. Their seats are starting to empty with 2.5 minutes to go.
Well, really, they hung tough in a game that was over really at the end of the third quarter of play. They stayed, they cheered, they tried to get them back in it when they were down by 24. Just couldn't get it done.
On the drive, Floyd will get the foul. Stephen Howard just in, played at DePaul.
John Lucas told us before today's game that his team had never played defense, and the guards in particular, like they played in game one, and he knew that they would have to be that tenacious, and they weren't. They started off fairly well, but then they broke down, and it was the Utah Jazz that were the aggressors and really took over the game from the second quarter on.
Floyd, it's the free throw. Walter Bond, John Crotty, Brian Russell all come in for the first time for Utah. This is Crotty, who played at Virginia. Bond from Minnesota. Howard, DePaul. Russell, Cal State Long Beach. Cummings knocks it away. Howard picks it up and scores. No basket. Foul.
Loose ball foul against David Benoit.
Three on him. A key factor in the first half and the comeback when San Antonio built an 8-point lead, seemed to have all the momentum, and then Jerry Sloan went to his bench, and Humphreys and Benoit sparked this Utah team while the rest of the club played such tough defense. When you think back on it, just after the first quarter, every shot was a tough one for San Antonio.
You know, you give that a lapse time of the number of minutes that they went, 16 and change, without a field goal. That tells you just how aggressive the Utah Jazz had become.
16 minutes, 25 seconds. San Antonio on its home court did not score a field goal from early in the second quarter to almost the end of the third, the middle of the third. 25 shots in a row they missed. Just when you think you've seen about everything. Foul on Cummings as Howard played in Italy a year ago. Goes up with a shot. Make the foul on Haley, his second. 85, the lowest scoring performance by the Spurs. That was at Houston. John Lucas was on that Houston team.
In 1980, so you know, he's wearing time well, and he doesn't want to remember that, and sure he'll tell his team, let's not have a repeat on game three.
They're gonna have to score 10 points to better that. Cummings with a rebound. 140 to go. Floyd a miss. Daniels the follow. 93-78. 13 for Lloyd Daniels.
11 here in the quarter, so John Lucas may be thinking about using Lloyd Daniels in game three because Dale Ellis has been struggling in the series.
Benoit. And Daniels with the rebound. Dale Ellis with only three in the game today. Haley. 93-80. We approach the 1 minute mark. That was the 25th field goal, and it equals how many Robinson scored in the season finale when he had that 71 point game. Barry Cummings and a foul. So the final score will be misleading.
It will be very deceptive if you didn't see any of the ball game. You think, well, that wasn't so bad. They were competitive, but David Robinson out for most of the latter part of the third and all of the fourth quarter of play. Very solemn over there and thinking about what this loss means.
How serious is that knee? He knows perhaps better than any. He did come back into the game, a good sign. And on the other bench, deep in thought is
John Stockton is right leg raised where he has that iced and bandaged, and you wonder, and as he must be, how healthy will I be for game three?
We said it was going to be a physical series. It's turned out to be that, and now the signs of a physical series are showing up.
Ekman will go the other way for San Antonio with 33 seconds to go. On these short series, best three of five, that road team knows they have to get at least one in order to even think about the second round. They have to get a victory on the road, and Jerry Sloan's team has that. It's going to be a happier ride home for Sloan and his club, knowing that all they have to do is win two and they're in the second round.
Still, the pressure is on the Utah Jazz. The home team has to hold serve, and certainly you feel good about winning one, but you got to make sure that you step up in that third game and win that game, or you know you're playing with your back against the wall again. These are all Jack Haley fans here.
This is his time, final minute. And he has 4 points. 94-84, so once a 30-point Utah lead down to 10.
Russell.
Ryan Russell, later the 49ers of Long Beach, has his first points. Haley, they want him to shoot. And that's it. Utah captures game two, an incredible San Antonio drought. They've had a lot of dry spells down here in South Central Texas. Never quite like the one fans saw in the Alamo Dome today in terms of the NBA. Utah takes advantage. They go home with the win. Stay tuned now, NBC Sports, for more NBA playoff action next as Shaquille O'Neal and the Orlando Magic endeavor to even their series. Reggie Miller and the Indiana Pacers. Steve Jones and Hannah Storm, I'm Dick Kent.